Okay, so let us start. Maybe a little bit, little reminder. So last time we were talking about the braiding model categories. And so what was happening there, just a reminder, braiding in a monoidal category, that was a natural isomorphism between the product of two objects and their product in the opposite order, some beta AB. And the requirement was roughly that jumping through the product of two objects at once should be the same thing as jumping over them one by one. And the same for the inverse braiding, because now we don't suppose that going like this is the same as going like that. And then we represented these kind of morphisms using braids. Something like that, where each of those crossings correspond to either beta or beta inverse, depending whether it's over and the left is over or under. And finally, we had a theorem saying that the resulting morphism depends only on the braid. When we deform the braid, then we get some new representations by having new type of crossings, but the same braid, then the resulting morphism is the same. And now finally, what is a symmetric monoidal category? Well, it's a braided monoidal category where this going over or under is the same thing. It's a braided monoidal category such that, what should I write, that beta AB is the same as beta BA inverse. Or in other words, this is equal to that. So in a symmetric monoidal category, it doesn't matter anymore whether you're going under or over. So let me just, both of them can be denoted simply like this. There are infinitely many reasonable or interesting examples of symmetric monoidal categories. Would be, say, anything that might come to your mind from sets. Category of sets with just the Cartesian product is naturally a symmetric monoidal category. Or when you choose some field, then the category of vector spaces with the tensor product is naturally a symmetric monoidal category. Then we always somehow have natural isomorphism, whether we take the product like this or take the product like that. And it's going to satisfy everything that we need. And for all purposes, we can just imagine that the product is commutative and that the thing is commutative again. Just when we somehow want to talk about it really correctly, then we need to remember that they are not AB and BA are not really equal. They are somehow canonically isomorphic. That's the thing. Maybe some more exotic example that, say, when you take the category of Lie algebras, is there some natural type of product? We can take direct sum as a product. It still is going to be associative and commutative in the sense of the symmetric monoidal category. Those things are naturally isomorphic. We know exactly what those isomorphisms are. Nothing surprising here. And all kind of other things, I don't know, maybe like one more. So if G is a Lie algebra, then the category of representations of G with tensor product of two representations is again a representation, and that's it. Okay, so we'll meet some of those examples again. What I should say still about those symmetric monoidal categories is that we again have some kind of coherence theorem. Now you see what happens, that if I take say four objects, if we have a symmetric monoidal category, and say I don't know A, B, C, D objects of C, and one thing that we can do, we can now take them in arbitrary order, like A, B, C, D. And take arbitrary bracketing of those things and have, A, B, C, D, and take this kind of parenthesization. And we can now pass from one type of product to the other one, just using either these symmetries, or if necessary, using those gammas, those re-bracketings. And in place of drawing a braid, I can now just draw those lines, simply crossing. We don't care anymore whether it's going under or over. So just anything works. It's like this. And the statement now, as you can imagine, is that between any two such products, there is exactly one morphism that one can build using those symmetries and the rebracketings. So now there is a theorem. And in a symmetric monoidal category, I don't see, also for any objects A1 up to AN, and any two, say, I'll write like this, a parenthesized permutations of these objects. There is a unique morphism or isomorphism, actually. Built out of gammas and betas. So if you compare it, what happened for a braided monoidal category, there we had a different statement. The statement was that there were as many of those isomorphisms as there were braids. That means for any braid connecting, if you draw a braid between this and that, then we get an isomorphism, and that isomorphism depended only on the braid. Now it's the statement is it doesn't matter how I draw those things anymore. We always get the same thing because overcrossing is the same as undercrossing, or if you wish, so what changes? When we pass from braided monoidal categories to symmetric monoidal categories, there are many ways how to say it. But one way that now the additional property that beta is its own inverse. This corresponds to additional relation in would be in the braid group, namely that sigma I is equal to sigma I inverse, that going under is the same as going over. And now we get simply a presentation together with this thing. Artinian relations become a presentation of the symmetric group. With the Artin relations, this is presentation of the symmetry group. Okay, I think it, in fact, any proof I would write would be less transparent than just looking at the picture. It's obvious that when you're simply allowed to draw those lines and you can move them as you wish, then there is exactly one way how to draw it. You simply connect each point with the corresponding point upstairs, and that's it. So there is a unique way how to do it. So if you compare the situation, what was happening in a monoidal category, there we needed to have the same order. There was no permutation allowed. We could only have different parenthesizations. And there was always a unique isomorphism between two different parenthesizations. In a symmetric monoidal category, it's now sort of improved. We can have arbitrary order, and there is a unique isomorphism. It's this, those braided monoidal categories which are sort of odd ones, that now there is not a unique isomorphism. There are, as for each braid, we're going to have an isomorphism, but that's why they are interesting. That's why one can actually do something with it. And so we shall use those braids in the end to provide quantization, say, of those Poisson-Lie groups or things like that. Now let me, okay, I can call it as a new small section, which is called parenthesized braids. So what is it? I'm just going to define a groupoid which contains in itself all the operations that one has in a braided monoidal category. So say, it's for the moment it's not so well explained, so I'll put it into quotation marks. So it's a groupoid of operations in braided monoidal categories. So what is it? So definition, it might be a bit longer, but it's very visual, and so nice. Possibly if you have colors, then it's going to be even colorful. So we start with a finite set. Usually elements of those finite sets would be denoted like those lowercase letters. So say, if A is a finite set, and then the groupoid, well, whatever I just wrote of parenthesized braids, whatever, maybe colored. I sort of made up the name. The details those details of the name were detail were made out on the spot. Parenthesized braids is an official name, so. Is, well, what is it? First of all, the notation is that it's parenthesized braids, let's say indexed by A. And now I should say, what are the objects? Objects are going to be these type of expressions. So we take arbitrary arbitrary ordering of our elements of A, so we choose a linear order if you wish, and parenthesizations. So say if A is A, B, C, D, then for example, anything of that form, whatever I wrote there, A, C, B, D, that's an object. It's not very thrilling, but that's what it is. And now, so you see what's happening for any object. We have somehow an operation in our in any braided monoidal category. We take here four objects, and we can then take their product in this way using the bracketing as it's indicating. So that's what it does. Now those morphisms. Morphisms are braids. With strands connecting the same letter. That written in words doesn't make any sense, I guess, because I'm going to draw a picture. That way it will make more sense. So I will take one object like this. I don't know. A, C, B, D, and here, A, B, no, C, D, for example, like this. And now let's see how many colors I can fetch. So the idea is now to take any braid which connects, does something of this form. Okay, so that's it.
Four objects are fixed. These four objects are fixed.
This is a single object of the groupoid. This is another object of the groupoid. And now I should now say what are morphisms between two objects of the groupoid, and this is one morphism between these two objects.
No, I mean this A, B, C, D are four fixed.
Yes. In the example, I'm using this example. That A, the set A, contains exactly these four elements, and so.
And so we have four objects in our braided category.
Yeah, it would somehow correspond to the four objects in our braided category. But this is now a abstract thing, which one can talk about it without talking about braided monoidal categories. So A, B, C, D are on this level, there are no longer objects in a Braidian monoidal category. They are just elements of a set. Okay, so that's it. Now I should say probably what is how one composes those morphisms, but this should be somehow clear that you just composition of braids. You take another braid and just stick them like that. And those colors are respected. So this is sort of mixture between braid group and pure braid group. That in a pure braid group, we are supposed to respect the color of the strand. Here we're still supposed to respect the color of the strand, but the strand doesn't need to return home because fortunately we have several objects. So it's no longer a group, it's a groupoid. And there is this useless looking parenthesization. It is just there because it somehow happens to be in Braidian monoidal categories. It's just a quick, stupid check. So if you take this PAB, I don't know, AB. So how many objects do we have in this groupoid?
A free group.
How many objects? I'm asked. It's a groupoid. It's a category with some objects. So how many objects does it have?
A lot.
So there are infinitely many, one, two. Yeah, it seems like two. No, there are only, you can only write AB or BA. So object of this guy, AB, BA. I don't need to write parenthesization because, well, there are just two of them. Now I'm not going to ask when it's, say ABC because I don't know. So it's probably like times two, right? So it's probably 12. So even with your help, I was able to compute. Yeah, and then when it comes to morphisms, yeah, there are infinitely many. These two things are isomorphic, but in the end, so what I say, what is the group of endomorphisms of a given object? AB. Yeah, so this should be Z, right? Oh, yeah, and it's isomorphic to Z. So it's generated by, we need to return to the original situation, right? So it's AB, so that we go back to AB. So it's like this. So this is generator. And now it depends on how many times we turn. It's not so bad. But there is also, there is some sort of simpler morphism which goes from AB to BA, which goes like this. Possibly even this deserves a name. It actually had a name for it. So it was this beta AB, I guess. One can just call it like this, simply in this simple example. Now, for a moment you were confused about whether these things are actually objects in a braided monoidal category or just simply abstract things. So now to come back to the confusion, because now you don't seem to be confused anymore and I want it back. So let's now make this following observation, or it's basically a reformulation of a theorem that we saw before. Or I can call it, again, the same theorem. The theorem would now say that for any finite set A, we have same and a braided monoidal category C. We have a functor which goes like this. And we take this P, A, B, A. It's like those operations that we can do on n, on objects indexed by A. And I can write it either like if we take times C power A to C, or equivalently I can write it as functor going from PAB now to functors from CA to C power A to A. So by this I mean the category of functors. Functors form a category with natural transformations. And yeah, basically see it, right? That's exactly what we had it for. Whenever we order those things, then we get an operation. Then we can say how to go from here to there, simply by taking product exactly in that order in that parenthesization. And for any two such things, whenever we choose a braid, we have a morphism. That exactly means that morphisms here go to morphisms there, who are natural transformations. Okay, so you're confused again. That's what I claimed I wanted to achieve, but maybe I overdid it. So you see what? So an element in an object in here, those would be like, it means that for any element in here, I choose an object in C. That means that those elements now they become actual objects. Okay. Now for those actual objects, I can now form that product, which is again an actual object. And that forming that product, well, it's actually functorial. Okay. It's really a functor going from here to there. But not just this, for any braid, we have a morphism between these two things, and that's this morphism, it's between this actual object and that actual object in our category C is natural. It's natural, meaning it's a natural transformation between those two functors going this way. Oh, you're still confused, and it's okay. So this is this definition of a braided monoidal category is somehow very encapsulated, that we have just those, in some sense, some generators there. We have a braiding, and then okay, we have actual product, or it's a monoidal category, then we have that reparenthesization, and we have a braiding. But then when we start composing those things, we get these things or these things. So now it's somehow this definition unwrapped into everything that we can get. And it's not still not somehow transparent enough. So there is one more thing which is happening here. You see, somehow, in some sense, certainly in those braided monoidal categories, all these operations, they are built simply from those three that I mentioned. Or, well, they are from one on morphism, sorry, for one on objects, just for taking products, and from two on morphisms. We just have this, we have reparenthesization and braiding. And it's not clear in what, how to put it here. So let me now say how to put it. So there is a I can either say that it's an operadic or operad structure on this PAB, or simply substitutions. So it's still a part of a structure that one has here. And the thing is that there are, these are functors when we have for any finite sets A and B and any A0 in A, we have a natural functor, which I will describe, which goes from PAB A times PAB B to, and the idea is to replace this one element with that entire set B. So we go to PAB A minus A0 and disjoint union with B. And what would it be? See, the idea, now, it comes from the fact that what would happen if this object A in a braided monoidal category is already product of some of several other objects. And that's what we want to achieve here. Well, so replacing A0 with an object, so it's a parenthesized word, of this P, A, B, B. So that's how it works on objects. So let me write some examples right now. A0, A1, A2. Let's suppose that this thing is an object of PAB, A0, A1, A2. And let's take another object, which is in, I don't know, whatever, B0, B1, B2. So there should be a map. There should be a map going from here to where we have what now? Where is this A1, A2, and in place of A0, we have all those three Bs. And what is this map? Let me do it here. The idea is simply to replace this A0, this one single letter, with this entire expression. So this goes to A1, and now I need to put this in parentheses, B0, B1, B2. Yeah, it's like this now, like that, okay, and A0. Or there I have
A2?
Oh yeah, A2. Thanks. I was concentrating on closing or parentheses, and naturally this is what happened. So it's a natural thing also from the point of view of this braided monoidal categories. We just imagine that A0 is actually a product of some other things. That's what we would do. And then for morphisms, the idea is to replace the strand or the A0 with the corresponding braid in our PA BB. Let me say, do it here. That's now somewhat trickier to draw, but let's say that we want to replace A with some ABC, EF. EF, and I know FE, and let's take the simplest thing that we can possibly have. So let's suppose that we want to replace A with this. Here we replace A with that, but now we also want to know what happens for morphisms. And the operation is, I should delete this strand. Still I remember where it was. I should replace A down here, it becomes EF. Up here it becomes FE. This way, and now I need to take this this braid and draw it very close to where the original strand went. So somehow very close means just so that it doesn't get entangled with other things. It just should go in some neighborhood of the original strand. So let me maybe draw it this way. Okay. So now we already have the braiding. So that's the transformation that we have there. So it's a functor going from this times that into that. This kind of functor. Now I wanted to avoid the official definition of what an operat is, but this is an example of an operat. Or maybe a remark. So this PAB is an operat. Well, operat in the category of groupoids, which means, let me spell the definition anyway, but A, the assignment that we assign to A, PAB, A, is somehow rather stupidly functorial. Is a functor, but from the category, from say finite sets, but where we keep only bijections as morphisms. So it's somehow functorial just in the sense that we can always rename those objects, but we cannot have non-bijective morphisms here. So that's certainly clear that this is true. And plus, and we have those substitutions. which satisfy some commutativity or associativity rules, depend on how to, which are commutative. In what sense? What one can do? There are two ways that two things that one can do. See, there are two rules or two possible ways. So either you have one A and we take two elements in A, and now substitute for this element some B1, and for this element we substitute some B2, and it doesn't matter in which order we do it, whether we first plug in this B1 and only then plug in B2, or whether we first plug in B2 and then plug in B1. So those two orders are the same. And the second thing, what we can do, we have somehow A, now we decide to substitute, replace one element with some set. But we can also, in the result, we can now choose another element, but we don't choose it in the original A, we choose it in this B. We can replace some element in B with some set C. And there are now two ways how to do it. You see, either we first make the substitution here, and only then we plug in C, or we first plug C into B, we replace this element of B with C, and then we take the result and plug into A, and the statement is that it doesn't matter, it gives the same outcome. And so anything which is functorial in this way has these kind of operations.
So it's the same isomorphism or
these are strictly the same. These are just equal, and the thing that possibly I should still explain. I said here this is in groupoids. So in general, it might be in a symmetric monoidal category. Now everything was called C, so let me call it what S something. Groupoids form a symmetric monoidal category simply by one can take simply the Cartesian products. That's what we were using here. But if you're in an arbitrary symmetric monoidal category, then this product needs to get replaced with the product in the symmetric monoidal category. And that's it. Otherwise, those two axioms remain exactly as they were before. Okay, and to close this parenthesized braid story, what one can now say that if, say, C is, in our case, a category, then when we assign to A the category of functors from CA to C, this thing, it's again, one still has those substitutions or compositions, if you wish. So if I already use those words, so this is naturally an operat in categories. But what does it mean? I mean, this is a stupid word maybe for something very simple. The idea is that if you go from CB to C, and now we go from CA to C. We have one set, another set. And now we just imagine that there is one particular element A0 in A. So one we choose one particular C. Then we can combine these two things into map, into a functor which goes from C power A minus A0 C. So there is this kind of substitution. We just simply take one variable from here and replace it with the outcome of this guy. And the statement now, the more precise statement is that if C is a braided monoidal category, then those functors, which goes from P A B A into HOM C A C, are compatible. Substitutions, or in other words, if you wish, it's a morphism of, remember this groupoid PABA and the fact that we can make those substitutions. And now let us make a break. So from those parenthesized braids, well, we're going to meet them from time to time. So just try to retain this picture that there are those nice colored braids and one can make substitutions for strands. And let us now start a new thing, which is called Drinfeld associators. And some way, if there is one main character in this course, then this is this one. So I should tell you what is a Drinfeld associator, but let me not tell it just straight away. So let's look at this kind of problem. Our original problem is that we start with a commutative algebra and want to produce some deformed non-commutative product. Algebra somehow deform to a non-commutative algebra. So let's call it problems. Because now we're going to talk about some other problem which is simpler than this one and which will help us to solve this problem at least in some particular cases, which is that let's start with this commutative on some other level. So let's start with a symmetric monoidal category. And now we want to somehow deform it and to obtain a braided monoidal category. Here, somehow in a commutative algebra, we might know somehow the first order part of this deformation. We might know somehow Poisson structure, so to say. I want this deformation to respect that Poisson structure. Now we're going to somehow look at what kind of data one needs in a symmetric monoidal category. Somehow what is the first order deformation to a braided monoidal category. And then we will do it. And the thing which does it is this Drinfeld associator. So a little bit of say notation. To simplify things, I will now suppose that our categories are linear. Meaning, so if C is a linear category, what it means, linear, it means that, we choose some field that's always in the background, some field. And now the set of morphisms between two objects is supposed to be a vector space over that field. And the composition is supposed to be bilinear. So So it means that the HOM AB is a vector space composition is bilinear. So if you have like something like this, then by C epsilon, I want to be able to talk about some kind of first order deformations. And this is the is simply the same category as C, but with morphism, so HOM in C epsilon between A and B will be HOM in C A and B, but where things can depend on a parameter, but such that its square is equal to zero. Somehow it's only first order thingy. So there would be epsilon modulo epsilon squared. Just this all little thing. And now, do I need anything else? Probably not. So let me write some definition of what would be a symmetric monoidal category together with the first order deformation. I'm trying to become a braid monoidal category, and it's very, there is no surprise here. So, and just only very long name, an infinitesimally braided monoidal category. I invented a wonderful shortcut for that. So this thing is just a, I say, a linear category C. With a braided let me do it this way. Put it this way. So it's a symmetric monoidal and linear category C together with a braiding on the category C epsilon such that modulo epsilon, this braiding is the braiding or symmetry in C. So what does it actually mean? So let's suppose that sigma AB to BA is the symmetry. This is the thing that I should call probably braiding, but it's now, I'll call it symmetry just because it's this thingy. C. Then, like so far, what we know only is that it's braiding AB. So, what is it? It's something like, let me write it this way. So I'll compose the symmetry with, and now here there should be one identity, and plus epsilon times whomever, right? Plus epsilon times some T AB. That's so far the content of the definition. Right? But there should be a braiding such that modulo epsilon is equal to sigma. So let me write it this way. I want to have a morphism that goes from AB to AB. I don't want to have these changes because they are TAB going from goes from AB to AB. And there is one additional requirement which might look a little bit strange, but it's very natural in the end. So with braiding and such that this additional requirement on this TAB that TAB is equal to TBA. What exactly, okay, maybe I should, I'm identifying too many things. So let me maybe put here quotation marks. Because what does it mean? You see, this TAB, that somebody goes from AB to AB. Now, TBA is somebody who goes from BA to BA. So what does it mean that I want these two things to be equal? It means that I'm misusing the fact that I can, using the symmetry, I can simply identify AB with BA. So the precise statement is, more precisely, and I will, of course, make a mistake, so TAB is equal to, so we probably have to go from sigma AB composed with TBA composed with sigma BA. I guess this is the right way how to write it. I first somehow use this identification between B and AB and BA, so there's the sigma. Then I can write my T, and then I have to go back to the original order, so I need to do this. So that's the definition now, somehow. Drawing, how to draw it. If you have A and B, then, sorry, I would draw this kind of chord. So this is what corresponds to TAB, which goes from tensor product of A with B to itself. There is some kind of chord. And what I want to say. So one thing that we can observe certainly that is TAB from AB to AB is natural, is a natural transformation. Just because of beta is a natural transformation. So everybody was a natural transformation, beta and sigma, therefore also these T's are natural transformations. And now, why do we require that this strange thing that TAB is equal to TBA? The reason for that, there are better reasons, but one naive and perfectly good reason is that, say, if we had something like TAB were equal to minus TBA, let's suppose that we had something like this, then if we compose beta AB with beta BA, what would we get in this case? We would get identity, exactly, because there would be like this. There would be one with plus epsilon, then we multiply the same with minus epsilon, the same stuff. Epsilon squared is equal to zero, so those terms go away. So this would be identity. And so this thing would be a symmetry. And so beta B A, which is sort of okay, we would deform our symmetric monoidal category to a symmetric monoidal category. But that's not, we wanted to get somehow something which is really braided. And so the idea is now that if you have arbitrary, neither symmetric, non-skew symmetric T, let's split it into symmetric and non-symmetric part, and anti-symmetric part, and that anti-symmetric part just gives us a deformation of our symmetric monoidal category as a symmetric monoidal category. We don't care about those. We really want to go for braiding. So that's one reason why to pick these. So I should give you some example. And that would be the example which that matters for quantization of Poisson-Lee groups or for Lie by algebras. Say, if, okay, I was calling it, let me call it the same way as it was for those Lie by algebras, so I'll call it D, even though it's a very bad letter. So if D is a Lie algebra, and now this time it's enough to have some T who is from second symmetric power of D and who is D invariant. So when the D is actually a Drinfeld double or something, somebody as we saw, D might be an inner product on D, well, inverse or put into D in place of D star. So it might, we don't suppose here that it's necessarily non-degenerate, but in when we actually use it, it's going to be of this form. So it means that this T, okay, so it is in here, so it's in G, one can see it as an element of G tensor G. So then the category of representations of G, G rep, or I don't know, whatever. Or it's not G, but D, or if you wish, UD modules. So this is going to be our category. So the category of representations of a Lie algebra is naturally a symmetric monoidal category. It means that on the tensor product, we have a tensor product of two representations is a representation. And not, but now there is this infinitesimal braiding. There is this TAB appearing here. So this guy is.
So there is also T in G.
Yeah. Then this guy is a braiding monoidal category. And how? What exactly is the braiding? Or is this infinitesimal braiding? It's TAB. Okay, it might be VW. These are now representations. I think it's not a nice thing to call vector space by lowercase a. So this guy is going from V tensor W to V tensor W. How do we do it? With this guy, right? It's simply the action by the T who is in D tensor D. So the first D acts here, the second D acts there. That's what it does. And this is that's an example. Now, why is it an example? We can just prove it straight away. But maybe it's good to good first to understand how to rephrase this definition of an infinitesimal braided monoidal category purely in terms of those TABs. So what do TAB satisfy? So in an IBMC, what we should have, you know, this is not the hexagon. For those betas, that should be equivalent to something for t's. What is hexagon? Hexagon is the statement that jumping through the tensor product of two things in one step is the same as jumping first over one thing and then, or there is under, and then under the other thing. And what is that hexagon now in terms now written for these betas? So let's take these betas. And let's just concentrate on the term that contains epsilon. We know that it just works for that sigma. There is no problem. But let's see what happens with that epsilon. So what happens with that epsilon? When we go through everybody in one step, we should get what? We should get some term containing like TA, BC. When you go first through B, with A only through B, then we should get T AB, and then we jump with A over C. So this should be the identity. Now the more I start explaining this equality, the less clear it becomes. But let me anyway do that. So what it actually somehow means, you see, this guy, that should be a morphism going from ABC to ABC. Now, this guy should also be a morphism going from ABC to ABC. But what's written here is that's not say exactly. So what I should really write, it should be like tensor with identity on C. I'll be systematically skipping these kind of things. And the same kind of thing here. It should be like tensored with the identity on B. But now in drawing, how to draw that thing? We have A, B, C, and now we want somehow to take this chord between A and BC combined into a single object. So that thing should be the same as taking the chord. Maybe I should first go with that stuff first here to see it better. Taking the chord here, there's this TAB and plus. If I really should stretch it, then I should like move this thing to meet this guy using the symmetry and take it this way. But frankly, I don't think that this picture explains it better than this picture. It's somehow way better to draw things without putting here those gammas and gamma inverses, and without putting here those sigmas and gammas, and etc. This is a better picture, I would say. And now, do you see, does our T that appeared here, does it satisfy this relation? Or why should it satisfy that if you act with that T, if you know, if I go from V tensor, W tensor, triple U, V tensor, W tensor. And parenthesize it like this. So what happens now? See, the trick is how Lie algebra acts on a tensor product. It's really sum of two things. either we're acting with in here and we just act with one on the other component, or plus we act with one here and with the thing on the other component. That's exactly this equation. So it satisfies and satisfied, and for more, if you're not yet convinced, then there are always exercises. Okay, so we have one nice, this is the only example that we're going to need. Maybe we'll meet more of them, but this is the one which will in the end the result in some non-commutative products on some algebras. Oh, sorry, I got lost in myself. Okay, so these are this kind of infinitesimal deformations of symmetric monoidal categories. And as we were doing for braided monoidal categories, let us look at some relations that are satisfied by those T's. So proposition, say if C is a high B and C, then those T ABs satisfy what one can call infinitesimal Artin relations. Which are, well, first of all, that I'll write it like this, that if A, B, C, D are all different, or whatever, then TAB commutes with TCD, and then there is a relation which uses three objects, which is that TAB, let me draw them, maybe those commas, TAB commutes with TAC plus TBC. So what are these relations? You see, on one hand, these are exactly the relations which are, because betas, they are braidings, so they need to satisfy Artin relations. These are exactly the relations that result from there, but let me just give a direct proof. So what is the first statement? The first statement is that if you take somehow TAB and it's really a tensor with the identity on CD, and composed with identity on AB tensor with TCD.
Sorry, the second one is also equal to
zero. Thanks. But I want to say that it's the same thing as if I write it in the opposite order. But why is it? Well, this is simply equal to TAB tensor TCD. And that's why it's equal to 1AB tensor TCD composed with TAB tensor 1CD. So this is some kind of repetition of the same stuff when we saw that then doing braiding, and then braiding is the same thing as doing this braiding here. And then, so whether I first do it on the left or on the right is the same thing. Because, but they are simply tensor products of two morphisms. I can write it in this way. That means that I don't need to, I can actually do them at the same time. There is no problem for doing it at the same time in the braided monomial category. This is the same idea here. And it's actually exactly the linear part of this, epsilon linear part of this first Artin relation. And the second thing is simply that PAB. Who is that stuff? Well, that stuff is PAB, C is equal to PAB, C PAB. And why is it? Because T is a natural transformation. Meaning, to put it, say, you see what's happening here. Here we have this AB, and now there is this C thingy. Use these colors. Now the question is whether it's true that if I put, okay, what is on this side? If I first put there this chord and only then apply T, whether it's the same as if I put the chord there. But that's simply true for any arbitrary endomorphism of this object AB. That's simply naturality. The fact that T is a natural transformation implies that whomever I put here, I can put him also up there. Doesn't matter. Now, if you remember, in a braided modular category, we observed similar things, but not for infinitesimal Artin relations, but just for Artin relations. And then straight away, we went to braids. Before this braided modular category, it was just a name that braided. But once we knew it, then we knew that we should look at braids. Now, let's see what's the corresponding infinitesimal braid thing that appears here. So that thing is called the Drinfeld. Definition is, or what we're going to take, basically, we are going to look at the algebra, which is generated by these kind of symbols, TABs, modulo these two relations. Now, since those two relations are given in terms of commutators, then it's good to define the thing as a Lie algebra, and the algebra itself is going to be the enveloping algebra of the Lie algebra, if you wish. So, definition is the Drinfeld. Drinfeld Kono algebra. Then here I'm again have a problem. I need to know how to write fracture T. So it should be this thing. So for that, I invented this wonderful way of writing it. Just great. I'll put an index this might be, say, a finite set. Or one can also. Okay, no. Let me stay close to what we had for braid group. So let me put there Tn. So that's a natural number. So Tn is defined by those symbols TIB, where A is different from B, and AB are between 1 and N, with relations that, well, there's only one that was imposed before, the TAB is equal to TBA, that thing, and plus those two, those infinitesimal Artin relations. So these guys. Or since I already started using that notation, I might also use that's better for this operadic point of view or operadic structure. So this thing for where this is a finite set is defined exactly in the same way, but now it's simply TAB, where those A and Bs are in A with exactly the same. With exactly the same stuff. So here somehow our A would be the set of 1, 2, 3 up to N, if you wish.
So why do you require they are different?
A, A, B different? Because those, I mean, there were always somehow two objects. Wait, it might be the same object, but somehow now they have their own separate lives. So like this chord was always drawn for two things. So that's why we required. So there was never an operation that would be just on a single object. There was always tensor product of two things on which we applied something. So this is some sort of Lie algebra, which is some infinitesimal version of braids, in some sense. We'll see them at some point better. In what sense this is a Lie algebra of the pure braid group? And now we have some sort of easy statement. How should I say it? So let me first put it slightly naively, and then let me put it in a correct way. That might be like the end for today. Let's see. So say slightly naively, the statement is that for any finite set, A, we have A, well, what I'd say, a functor. C, if C is infinitesimal braided, then we should have a functor going from the enveloping algebra of this TA to HOM CA C. So how should I understand this? Okay, this is an algebra. An algebra can be seen as a category with a single object. Bra category with a single
linear.
Sorry? A linear, yeah. to have equality, then I should say it's a linear category with a single object. So the endomorphisms of that single object is that's our algebra. And now the statement is that we have a single object here, so we should have a single object there, a single functor going from CA to A. And that's not entirely true, because what I'm saying, let's take several objects. Let's take like objects A, B, C. And now I have all those possible ways how to form their product. And here, that's why it's naive, because I already identified all of them, imagining that our product is strictly commutative and associative, which is not an entirely bad thing to do, but it's also not entirely correct. But let's imagine that the product in C is strictly commutative and associative. So naively means if this thing in C is strictly commutative and associative. So that's the naive thingy. But modulo that, what happens? You see, each of these TABs become a natural transformation, and they satisfy these relations. Let's say by definition of the symmetry is already in the definition of infinitesimal Braid modular category, and then we derive those infinitesimal Artin relations. So we certainly have this kind of thing. So less naively, the only thing that I need to add is the fact that this product is not really strictly commutative and associative. So that's the only thing one needs to deal with. And now for that one needs some silly definition. So PAP, I'm not responsible, strangely, for this terminology. Even though it's so silly, it's not me who came up with it. So this stands for parenthesized permutations, and it's the same as, say, operations in symmetric monoidal categories. So what is this? It's the same stuff as we saw for those parenthesized braids, except that now it's way simpler and boring. So somehow this is a groupoid. Objects are the same as for PAB. And a unique morphism between any two objects. And so the right formulation of that thing is now that, so the right is that we have a functor. Okay, so C is infinitesimal braided. Then we have a functor which is not really from here, but we need to add there those silly things. Functor goes from PAP A times the enveloping algebra of TA into HOM CAC. So one can put it this way, that these are operations, or abstract operations, or general operations in infinitesimally braided monoidal categories. And so for any particle with infinitesimally braided monoidal categories, those things actually become true operations. And we have this functor thingy. Do we still have like 1 minute? I should probably still tell you what is the operat structure behind that. But it will only take 1 minute, so it's going to be very fast. Operat structure that should be something going from UTA tensor UTB to UTA minus A0 composed with B, sorry, disjoint union with B. And what is it like? The thing is, it's enough to say what is on generators. And, well, the only thing that enters is that we understood this thing, like this TA, BC, as being equal to TA, B plus TA, C. That's the operatic structure. That's what enters here. So the idea is that A0 maps to, now I replace this A0 with a product of those things entering, so I need to take the sum of all of those. So it's going to be sum TAB with all B in B, and now let me call it a T, I know. I need some string, letters, whatever, alpha, beta. Alpha, beta goes to itself, T alpha, beta, if this A0 is not one of those. Alpha, beta. And so this that map is compatible with this operatic structure. Okay. So that's all for today. There were not yet any Dirichlet associators, but that's where we start next time.